Hello everyone, welcome to Botany Arts channel for UPSC examination. Friends, in today's video lecture, we are going to understand what is the structural features of a typical plant leaf. Okay, we are going to consider many type of leaves and what type of structural features they possess. This we are going to elaborate in very detail. All right, so before starting the video, I request you to join our Telegram channel of Botany Optional for UPSC examination on the Telegram platform, so that you will not miss any update relating with this particular channel, because on regular basis we upload there the notes and the video link. We are only making the content relating with the botany, so if you are preparing for any examination which are relating with the botany, this channel is for you, and please make sure to subscribe and like that. And if you are preparing for the UPSC mains examination and botany is your optional subject, for that we have created the memberships videos in which the detailed lectures on a particular topics which are relating to the core botany syllabus are also available on our channel. So please make sure to take these memberships in order to speed up your botany preparation for the UPSC mains examination. So let's begin with the structure of leaf. Okay, now consider the definition, the very definition of the leaf. See, the leaf is the dorsoventrally compressed. Now what this word means, see, dorsoventrally compressed means the on the dorsal side and on the ventral side, from both the side generally the leaves are the compressed. Whether it's the back side or the front side, you will find majority of the time it is compressed from both the side. Observe this particular picture, this leaf. You will understand its back side and the front side, or say dorsal side and the ventral side, both are flattened. That is why we always use the word dorsoventrally compressed to explain the leaf. Okay, so the thing which is flattened from both the surface, we use the word for that dorsoventrally compressed. So on the similar lines, the leaf is also a dorsoventrally flat structures. Then they are the lateral appendages. Now why we are explaining them as a lateral appendages? Observe this second picture. Here comes the main stem. Okay, this is the stem, and from this stem these leaves are arising and growing laterally, and that is why we describe them as a lateral appendages, because they are laterally attached to the straight stem. Okay, and that is why we use the term lateral appendages of the stem produced at the nodes. Okay, this is very important. As you know, the stem of every plant is divided into the nodes and the internodes. Okay, just like here we have the nodes, here we have second node, here we have third node, here we have fourth node. While in between the node, whatever the space remained there, this space is called as the internode. Okay, so on the one hand we have the nodes, and on the other hand we have the internodes. But if you look carefully, the leaves are always born on the nodes. Okay, observe in this particular picture, see, here is the node, here is the node, and from this node these leaves are arising and growing laterally, and in between the node what we have is the internode. On this internode generally there are no leaves. Okay, so on the stem, whenever the leaf is born, it will always born on the nodes, and it is specialized to perform the photosynthesis. Yes, of course, it's a main photosynthetic organ for the plant, because it contains the plenty amount of chlorophyll molecule, and due to this chlorophyll presence, due to this chlorophyll pigment, this particular structure in the plant, which is called as the leaf, is able to photosynthesize rapidly and create the food in this particular process. Okay, so what is leaf? Leaf is dorsoventrally flattened structure, and it's a lateral appendage on the stem. Then it will always born on the node, and it is specializes in the photosynthesis. All right, now let us consider, see, the leaves may be round. Okay, now shape wise the leaves vary from plant to plant. Okay, if you observe one plant, you will find one type of leaf. If you find other kind of plant, you will find another kind of leaf. And if you go through the plant kingdom, you will find the different kinds of the leaf shape were there. The leaves do not show the uniformity in their structure. Sometimes they are round, sometimes they were needle like, sometimes they are scale like, sometimes they are cylindrical, and sometimes they are heart shape, or even the fan shape, or the thin or the narrow. Okay, all these variations are there. Observe this picture. This picture is of the pinus. Okay, what you are saying is the pinus leaf. These are pinus leaf are needle like leaf. Okay, you can observe here, this is the needle like leaf. This picture shows you this is an heart shaped leaf. This is a needle shaped leaf, while in the fourth picture you are seeing the leaf of the Ginkgo biloba. Okay, and as you know, Ginkgo biloba is an gymnosperm, and it is showing the fan like leaf. Okay, so the shape varies from plant to plant. Okay, sometimes they appear heart shaped, sometimes they appear the needle shape. Sometimes they appear fan like, but the majority of the time their function remains the same, is to photosynthesize. Okay, that is, the photosynthesis is their main function, and regardless of their shape or size, they always do this particular process called as photosynthesis. And they are sometimes thin as well as narrow as well. Okay, so leaves, they may vary in the shape. For example, they can be round, needle, scale or cylindrical, heart or fan shape. All right, now consider, see, they vary in the size from those of the raffia palm. Observe this. This is a particular picture of the raffia palm, and the botanical name for this raffia palm is the raffia rufia. Okay, this is an important plant, for its one characteristic is that its leaves can grow up to the 20 meters, like 65 feet. Yes, you heard it right. 65 feet long leaves are there in this particular plant of raffia, which is a palm plant. These leaves can grow up to the 65 feet in length. So lengthwise, the 65 feet long leaf are there in the plant kingdom. And even there are two smaller leaves which are found in the watermill plant, which is called as the wulfia. Okay, even these leaves are so small that if 16 leaves, if you place the 16 leaves one after the another, it will barely measure up to the 2.5 centimeters, that is equal to the 1 inch only. So on the one hand, we have the raffia like leaves which can grow up to the 65 feet, and on the other hand, in the wulfia we find such a smaller leaf that even we can place the 16 leaves at a line in a line, yeah, still they will not measure more than the 2.5 centimeter, which is equal to the 1 inch only. So lengthwise they also vary in the plant kingdom. In the plant kingdom you will find a 65 feet long leaves, but at the same time you will find the 2.5 centimeter leaves which are together collectively created by the 16 leaf if we place them together in the wulfia. So wulfia is producing the smallest leaf while the raffia is producing the largest leaf. So lengthwise they also vary in the plant kingdom. Okay, now see, the whatever the green color of the leaf is there, it is due primarily due to the presence of the chlorophyll pigment. As you know, this chlorophyll pigment is present in the leaf, and this chlorophyll pigment is largely responsible for the photosynthesis to create the food by using the sunlight, then the CO2 from the atmosphere, and H2O, that is water from the soil. By using all these gradients, these chlorophyll pigment create the food for the plant. Now these chlorophyll molecule is abundantly present in the leaf, and due to the green color of this chlorophyll molecule, the whole leaf turns to the green color. Okay, you will find majority of the time, 99% of the time, you will find the leaf of the plants are the green leaf. Now why they are green? Because of the presence of the chlorophyll pigment, which is largely responsible for the food production in the process of photosynthesis. Okay, now see, leaves are always born at the nodes, as we have discussed, and often have the axillary bud in the axils. Okay, whatever the axil is there for the leaf, in that axil they will always bear the axillary bud from which the new leaf were coming out. Now these leaves have the limited growth and lack the apical bud or the growing point. See, very very important that whatever the leaf is there, consider this leaf, whatever the leaf is there, this leaf has the limited growth. And why we are calling it is of limited growth? Because they lack the growing point. Here you will do not see any type of growing point or the apical bud. They will grow to the certain length and after that they will stop growing. Okay, and in some plant they abscess itself from the parent plant and they fall on the ground. So they are the structure of the limited growth. Okay, they grow very limitedly, and this limited growth limits their size to a particular limit. Okay, and beyond this particular limit they cannot grow, and they likes to stay within that length range. Okay, so leaves are the limited growing parts of the plant, while on the other aspect, the stem can be growing unlimitedly because they are possessing the apical growing point. But this apical growing point is not present in the leaf, hence they are rightfully described as the structures of the limited growth in the plants. Okay, now structure wise when we consider the leaf, when you see the leaf, see, you will find there are the three structures which collectively constitute the leaf. Okay, what are these three structures? These are three structures are the leaf base, then the petiole and the lamina. Okay, now generally whenever the non-botanist or the non-biology student see the leaf, he call the lamina as the leaf. Okay, because the lamina is the majority of the portion which is occupied by the leaf, because lamina occupies the majority of the portion of the leaf, and hence for who belongs to the non-biology background, they say lamina as the leaf, but it is not right. The leaf is actually made up of the three parts. The very first part is the leaf base, second part is called as the petiole, and the third part is, it's called as the lamina. The leaf base is also called as hypopodium, petiole called as the mesopodium, and the lamina is called as the epipodium. So by collectively, by considering all these three structures, these are three structures together constitute the whole leaf. Okay, so the green color of the leaf is due to the chlorophyll pigment. Then they possess the bud in their axils for the next leaf growth, and they are of a limited growth organs. Okay, they are made up of the three structures: leaf base, petiole, and the lamina. Now let us consider them one by one. Understand the leaf base. Okay, now see, the part of the leaf attached to the stem or the branch is known as the leaf base. Now understand this through this diagram. See, whatever the portion of the leaf, this portion is directly attached to the stem. Now whatever the leaf portion which is directly attached itself to the stem, this portion is called as the leaf base. And as you know, which type of function is done by this leaf base? It is attaching the rest of the whole leaf with that of the stem. So whatever the structure of the leaf which is attached itself to the main stem, this portion is called as the leaf base. Then see, these leaves which possess the stipule are called as stipulate leaves. Understand this. What are the stipules? Now see this second picture. Here you will find this is the first stipule. Okay, this one is the first stipule, and this one from the another side is the second stipule. And see where they are coming out. They are coming out from the leaf base, and that is why we are taking this particular stipulate thing into the leaf base. Okay, because understand this portion is called as the leaf base, through which this particular leaf is attached itself to the main stem. This is the male stem, and from this main stem here comes the petiole. This portion is called as the petiole, and the rest of the portion is called as the lamina, which is same here. See, this is the leaf base, this is an petiole, and then rest of this portion is called as the lamina. Okay, so these are three structures together constitute the whole leaf. And see here, right from the base of the leaf, a structure is created which is called as the stipules. These stipules are born on the leaf bases. Now see, whenever the stipules are present in the leaf bases, such a type of leaves were called as the stipulate leaves. Okay, if the stipules are there, then the leaf is called as the stipulate leaf, and if these stipules were absent in the leaf, then it is called as the ex-stipulate leaf. Okay, so depending upon the presence of the stipule in the leaf base, there are two kinds of leaves. The very first kind is the stipulate leaves, and the another kind is called as the ex-stipulate leaves. Okay, see, these stipules are green in color. See, observe this here. These are green in color, and they can perform the photosynthesis and also protects the buds. Okay, whatever the buds which are growing for the next leaf generation, these leaf buds are got protected by these particular stipules, and being green in color, these stipules can also photosynthesize. So this is the functions of the stipules, which is done to protect the leaf buds and to perform the photosynthesis. Now see the second portion of the leaf, which is called as the petiole. Now see, this petiole connects the lamina with the stem. See, this portion is called as the lamina. Okay, lamina of the leaf, and this portion is the petiole. Okay, so this petiole is connecting this whole lamina with that of the stem. Okay, it is an intermediate part between the stem and the lamina. So whatever the structure of the lamina is there, this lamina is completely attached itself to the main stem through a structure which is called as the petiole. So if there is a presence of the petiole in the leaf, it is called as petiolate leaf, and if there is a no presence of the petiole in the leaf, it is called as the non-petiolate leaf or the sessile leaves. Okay, so depending upon presence or absence of the petiole, the leaf can be of two types: the petiolate leaf and the non-petiolate leaf. All right, now consider, see, the petiole may be cylindrical, that is solid. Okay, sometimes it is very solid structure, and sometimes it can be hollow, just like in the papaya plant. Okay, observe in this particular picture here, whatever the petiole you are seeing, this petiole is the cylindrical petiole, or say the solid petiole is there. But if you observe the papaya plant, in that papaya plant you will see the long petiole like this, and then there are the bigger leaves which born on it. Okay, but these internal areas of these petiole is completely hollow. Okay, even you can see from this side, and you can observe this side as well. Okay, so the petiole may be cylindrical or the rigid, and they can be hollow, just like in the papaya. Now see, what is the function of this petiole? What function petiole does for the leaf? See, petiole raise the lamina to expose it more to the light and air, and to help in the conduction. See, very important, due to the presence of this particular petiole, the lamina of the plant comes in a contact with the air and light. okay, due to this particular petiole presence, the length of the leaf got increased, and these particular lamina come out of the shade, and it will directly come in contact with the more light and the air. Both the things are essentially required for the photosynthesis, because through the light, the sunlight got absorbed, and from the air, the CO2 is got absorbed in the process of photosynthesis. So it is very important for the any leaf to come freely in the light and the air in order to perform the photosynthesis. And this exactly function is assisted by these petioles. Okay, and at the same time, it helps in the conduction. Now, how? Whatever the food material is got created in these particular leaves, these leaves will transport this food material through the petiole, and it will reach all over the plant body. At the same time, whatever the water is coming from the roots, this water is coming from the roots via stem, and via petiole it goes to the other parts of the leaves. So important function of the conduction, whether it is a food or water, it is also done by the petiole. Okay, so petiole can perform the function by extending the lamella into light and air, and also the major function of the conduction, whether it is a food or the water. Okay, so this is the second portion of the leaf, which is called petiole. Now see the third portion, which is called as the lamina. Now it is the largest portion of the leaf, because consider leaf base and the petiole are the smaller portion, but the larger portion of the leaf is considered as a lamina, because it is the biggest looking and the first thing you see in the leaf structure is the lamina, because it is quickly observable, right? It's the largest and the flattened, right? The lamina is quite flattened, and due to this flatness, green and the most important part of the leaf. Now it is green, and why we are calling it as the most important part? Because it can perform the photosynthesis and it can create the food. As it is green in color, it is possessing the chlorophyll pigment, and this chlorophyll pigment in the process of photosynthesis create the food, and this food then later distributed throughout the plant body. So the very, very important function of photosynthesis is done by the lamina, and hence we rightfully describe them as a most important part of the leaf. Because the leaf base or the petioles are not performing photosynthesis, but whatever the photosynthesis is coming from the petiole or the leaf base, it is very small in amount, but whatever the main photosynthesis, 99% of the photosynthetic product is got created by the lamina. Okay, and due to this, it is the most important part of the leaf. Now it plays a very important role in the photosynthesis and the transpiration. Now we have discussed photosynthesis, how the photosynthesis occurs in the lamina. It also performs the process of the transpiration. Now what is transpiration? Transpiration is nothing but the evaporation of the water from the leaf surfaces in the form of water vapor. Okay, when the water is removing out of the plant body in the form of water vapor, it is called as the transpiration, and the majority of the time it occurs through the leaf. Okay, this transpiration helps the plants to remain cool during the dry condition. Okay, so the leaf performs the two important functions, that is the photosynthesis and the transpiration, and both of these functions, that is the photosynthesis and transpiration, is collectively done by the lamina part of the plant. Okay, so leaves structurally is made up of the three portions. The very first is the leaf base, then the second portion is the petiole, while the third portion is the lamina. We have described all these three, and we have discussed the function of all these three as well. Okay, so this is all about this topic. Okay, thank you very much for watching this video. Please like this video, share this video with your friends who are studying the botany, and if you haven't subscribed to the Botany Obsession channel yet, please subscribe to the Botany Obsession channel for UPSC examination. Again, thank you very much for giving your time. See you in the next video lecture. Thank you.